to sleep in tents in Hinman Hall in the richest country in the world because they don't have their own homes. Our sinfulness is Ferguson and racist frat houses that sadly are not as much the exception as we would like to think. It's the violence that's perpetrated by religious extremists of all faiths, whether it's Islamic terrorists like ISIS or Christian terrorists that bomb abortion clinics and stand at funerals of dead soldiers because they're protesting that our country is going to hell because of gay and lesbian people. The cross shows us that the problem with us is us. But it also shows us the great depth that God was willing to go in order to save us from our worst selves so that we could be our best. Jesus said to Nicodemus, just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that God gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him may not perish but have eternal life. When I was a child, John 3:16 was one of the very first Bible verses I learned and memorized. Anybody else? Just one? Two? Five? Can I get ten?
How about up here?
Well, it was probably the same for some of you, and to keep the tradition going, our Sunday school children are learning it during this Lenten season, too. John 3:16 is hands down the most popular Bible verse in the entire world. Martin Luther encouraged people to think of it as the gospel in miniature. If you Google John 3:16, you will get 73,900,000 hits in 18 seconds. That's how popular it is. It's been translated into more languages than any other piece of literature. You can find it on t-shirts, on coffee mugs, on baseball caps. And to my chagrin, you can still see it held up at sporting events for reasons really that are beyond my comprehension. But in spite of all of this, it is still a verse that resounds with good news. God so loved the world that God gave Jesus. What an amazing message it was that Jesus shared with Nicodemus in that late night conversation. That God loved and God gave Jesus, and that God still loves and gives Jesus to the world, including us. That God loves in Jesus so that everyone who believes in him, that everyone who trusts him will not die meaningless deaths, but will have eternal life. And eternal life, and I can't say this enough, eternal life is not just about life after death. Eternal life is about life before death, living the abundant, rich, meaningful life that Jesus came to give, living life in the presence of God. But when we focus so much on John 3:16, we forget about how important John 3:17 was in Jesus' little talk with Nicodemus. Because these two verses belong together. And the second verse helps to interpret the first. For God so loved the world that God gave Jesus. And then it goes on to say, indeed, God did not send the Son to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. These verses don't say that God so loved the church. Sometimes we think that we are the inside people who get all the goodies from God. But Jesus says God so loved the world, and that's what Jesus wanted Nicodemus and us to understand. That he has come to bear God's saving and healing word to the world. It's a wondrous love. We heard it on the saxophone. We'll sing it in a little while because God's love is the kind of love that changes people. It's the kind of love that even ourselves, the love that pushes and prods us and unceasingly prays for us so that we can be the people we were meant to be. It's the love that lifts us up and sends us out into the world so that we will be agents of God's justice and instruments of God's peace. It's the love, brothers and sisters, that will never, ever let us go. God so loved the world that God sent Jesus, because God's desire is not to condemn the world, but to save it. How many people stay away from Christian churches because they believe that rather than being embraced by that love, they will be excluded by judgment and condemnation? Just talk to a recovering alcoholic or somebody who's divorced, or an ex-con, or somebody who's gay or lesbian. While some of them will speak about the warm reception they've received, far too many will have plenty to say about how the church has alienated them more than it has accepted them. And honestly, this is one of the things that keeps our young people away from church, because they want to be a part of a church that doesn't keep people out, but invites them in and welcomes them home. And sometimes church folks can really be very critical. But according to this, if judgment and condemnation were not Jesus' job, then they surely should not be ours. The church exists for the sake of the world. And our purpose is not to judge, but to reach out in love, not to condemn, but to compassionately care for those who are lost and those considered least by the world. You see, God called us into being for the sake of the world, and our mission is to gratefully go out into the world every day, taking our baptism so seriously that we share the love of Christ and the might of Christ in a broken and hurting world. Our call really is to lift high the cross of Jesus and what we do so that people will see that we were created for good work, created to show Jesus' love, Jesus' willingness to take on all the violence in the world to once and for all eliminate violence. Our call is to be little Christ in the world. For God so loved the world that God gave not only Jesus, but Linda and Norma and Courtney and Sophia and Thomas and Kathleen and St. Isaac.